Today on Upfront, is a grand bargain back on the table in Washington? And does the sequester threaten a rebounding U.S. economy? My guest is Republican Congressman Sean Duffy.
You see different sides very far apart right now. And the only way you bring people together is you have a conversation. You have to talk to each other.
Then a new push to toughen drunken driving laws. Why does it remain so hard to change OWI laws in Wisconsin? Plus, an Upfront 12 News exclusive. Tommy Thompson on losing the election, his future, and the future of the Republican Party.
Get knocked down, you either have to stay down and wallow in your pity or get pick yourself up and do something else.
It's all this week on Upfront.
Honest, candid, insightful. This is Upfront with Mike Gouchet.
Hello again, everyone, and welcome to Upfront. We're now into the second week of the sequester, but there were signs last week the White House and Congress might be ready to at least talk about a grand bargain that would deal with the nation's deficit problem. President Obama had dinner with a number of Republican senators, including Wisconsin's Ron Johnson, and followed that up by having lunch with Wisconsin Congressman and House Budget Committee Chairman Paul Ryan. Are these encouraging signs, or is too much being read into those chat and chews? We're joined now by the Republican Congressman from Northwestern Wisconsin, Sean Duffy. Congressman, it's good to have you back on the program.
Hey, thanks for having me back, Mike.
So are you encouraged by the president reaching out and by these less formal discussions?
I am. And to add one more topic on, the president's going to come and talk to the House Republican Conference next week. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, listen, you see different sides very far apart right now. And the only way you bring people together is you have a conversation. You have to talk to each other. And so I think the president saw his act of traveling around the country and doing this campaign-style set of rallies hasn't really worked. If we're going to get something done, we have to sit down and talk, decide what is going to work, what's not going to work, what we can agree on, what we can't agree on, and move forward, hopefully, with a plan that is going to work for the country. And the president drives those conversations. I'm happy that he's coming in. I look forward to the conversation with him.
What do you have to talk about? If Republicans have said absolutely no revenue increases, the president has said needs to be a balanced approach, his words, what do you have to talk about?
Well, I think, first of all, we have to be clear on language, because when the president talks about a balanced approach to deficit reduction, we have to be clear that he's saying we are never going to balance the budget. We'll talk about reducing deficits, but if you ask 50 years from now, 100 years from now, we'll borrow for each one of those years. We'll never balance it.
So it's a balanced approach, but doesn't balance the budget. That's
right.
What you're saying?
And that's the truth of it. And I think a lot of people don't understand when he says balanced approach that the budget never balances. And so I think we have to come together and say, Mr. President, I know you don't agree with what the House is going to put out in their budget that's going to balance, but I think it's incumbent upon you as a leader to actually come forward with a budget that will balance at one point in our future. And if you want to say, I want to raise all these taxes, not just on millionaires and billionaires, but middle-class Americans, tell America that. But show us how you get to a point of balance. And when the Senate does their budget, they should do the same thing. And from that starting point, you can then have a conversation by looking at both budgets and coming together to find a pathway forward for everybody.
How worried are you about the impact of the sequester as it begins to drag on? We're now entering the second week.
We're $85 billion when we spend $3.6 trillion. It's a small percentage of what we spend in the government. There's a lot of fat that we can cut. I mean, American families, they've been able to cut 2% out. Small businesses, manufacturers, they've been able to cut 2% out. No one thinks that the federal government runs at 100% capacity. There's a lot of fat to be cut. My concern, though, is if the president wants to make a political move on this and start to cut actual necessary services that are provided, like air traffic controllers at Wisconsin airports, meat inspectors, TSA inspectors, not allowing kids into the White House to go on their class tour. I mean, those kind of things, I think, can be painful. But we passed a continuing resolution to fund the government for the rest of the year earlier this week, and we are giving the president the flexibility to cut spending in a more appropriate and effective way.
You don't see any government shutdown. You think that's definitely not going to happen?
Well, the government is funded through March 27th.
Right.
We passed a funding proposal that's very clean that uses the sequester number. We're going to send it to the Senate, and hopefully they'll pass it as well. And the president doesn't want to shut down. We don't want to shut down. So we've done our work in the House. Now it's incumbent upon the Senate and the president to do their work and make sure we keep the government funded.
Let me pursue the sequester point a little bit further, because here's the question. On Friday, new jobs numbers came out. They're pretty encouraging. Unemployment's at its lowest rate in 4 years or so. Don't you, your party, the president, don't all of you in Washington feel under pressure to make sure that government doesn't muck up what appears to be a rebounding economy?
Well, first of all, yeah, we want the numbers are encouraging. I mean, 236,000 jobs created. It's a good number. We saw the unemployment rate drop to 7.7%. If you actually add people back in who stopped looking for work, it's much higher. But we're going in the right direction. That's positive. But to think that you can't cut the, you know, we spent $2.2 billion on free cell phones, $27 million on Moroccan pottery classes. We pay for the travel expenses for the Watermelon Queen in Alabama. I mean, story after story about wasteful spending in government, in the federal government. Let's cut that. I mean, it's incumbent upon us to do that, Mike, because, listen, if we continue on the current course, we're going to pass this debt off to those little preschoolers, those little toddlers, those little infants, those young Americans. They're going to be responsible for paying back the irresponsibility of this generation. They're going to inherit a lower standard of living. They're the real victims of this policy. I mean, this debt is so big that we have to have a real conversation that if we're going to borrow the money with the understanding that we're not going to pay it back, that's the first time in our history that we've done that. And I think that's unacceptable. And I think if people know that, they would encourage more responsibility with their federal government.
This coming week, House Republicans will unveil their budget. It supposedly takes care of the deficit in 10 years. Give me a sense, and we don't have a lot of time here, but give me a sense of whether or not there will be so-called tax loopholes included in your plan. Will they be eliminating tax loopholes?
We have a proposal that will close the loopholes and reform the tax code, making the code fair, flatter, and simpler. Now, the specifics of it will go to Ways and Means, the tax writing committee. But as part of the budget proposal, we want to close those loopholes. I mean,
So you're willing to raise revenues if you lower tax rates. Is that correct?
Well, no, what we're trying to do is raise revenue by growing the economy. But what we're trying to do is close those loopholes and then have a fairer, simpler, flatter code where we can reduce tax rates for everybody, which will stimulate and grow the economy.
You're optimistic.
I really am, and especially with the president willing to finally come and talk to Senate, House leaders, we're going in the right direction.
Republican Congressman Sean Duffy from the northwestern part of the state. Good to have you back on the program.
Thanks,
appreciate
Mike.
It. Next, a new effort to change drunken driving laws in Wisconsin. It was a non-starter last session. Will it be any different this time and later?
It's a great place. It gives me a great deal of serenity and humility, and I love being up here.
Down on the farm with Tommy Thompson, talking about loss and life after the election. That's when Upfront continues.
Upfront with Mike Gouche, brought to you by American Transmission Company.